Well, good evening. Sometimes I need to hear this first song. I need it replaying in my head. Victory in Jesus. We have the victory. Let's sing together.
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about His groaning, of His precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and He bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Cleansing power revealing, how He made the lame to walk again, and calls the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and He bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion He has built for me in glory. And I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and He bought me with His redeeming blood. He plunged me ere I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Thank you, Lord Jesus, for that victory. Lord, help us to live in that victory. Help us to abide in You each day, each moment. Lord, I ask that as we are gathered here this evening, You'd soften our hearts. Help us to hear Your voice more clearly. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
And there is love that came for us, humbled to a sinner's cross. You broke my shame and sinfulness, you rose again victorious.
Faithfulness none can deny, through the storm and through the fire, there is truth that sets me free. Jesus Christ, He lives in me.
You are stronger, sin is broken, you have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen, Jesus, you are Lord alone. No beginning and no end, you're my hope and my defense. You came to seek and save the lost, you paid it all upon the cross. You are stronger, sin is broken, you have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen, Jesus, you are Lord of all. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. You are stronger, you are stronger. Sin is broken, you have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen, Jesus, you are Lord of all.
What gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need His power is displayed. To this I hold, my Shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley He will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but through Christ in me. no fate I dread. I know I am forgiven. The future sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and he was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are released. I can sing, I am free, and not I, but through Christ in me. With every breath, I long to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home. And day by day, I know he will renew me, until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Sing that again.
When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Lord Jesus, I just thank you for that work on the cross that you did for us. I pray, Lord, that tonight, as we're praying, as we're singing, as we're diving into your word, that we would be honoring to you. Lord, I pray that we would have true and honest hearts of worship, Lord. Lord, answer each prayer that's cried out here in just a minute. Speak to us in a way that we can understand. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's spend some more time with the Lord, but in prayer this time. You're welcome to get in groups or just pray by yourself.
Any requests that we want to share with the group tonight? Colleen Thomas has apparently gone through a mild stroke. She is currently in room 366 at Clear Lake Methodist, where she finally got a room. She was in the ER all night, not because she needed to be in the ER, but because they didn't have a room for her. When I talked to Chris last, which was about 5 o'clock this evening, they had still not done an MRI, but Chris describes her speech as sounding like she has a cold, and she has no paralysis, so it was mild, but still worthy of our prayer. We have also are getting ready to accept another challenge from the Lord as far as a Christmas festival is concerned, because we had blue skies and calm winds planned and nice 68 degree temperatures. The Lord has another plan, it looks like. When I saw the news this evening, the rain chance for Saturday was up to 80%. And we're still looking at winds probably blowing about 30, at least for a portion of the day. So hallelujah, what he wanted, the Lord wanted, he's wanted people to come inside the church. So the outreach committee has decided to bring at least the vendors and the crafts inside the building here. And we're going to make this work somehow, and God will be glorified, and we'll get to know our neighbors just a little bit more than we would outside. However, we're hoping we can still maintain the hayride, the live nativity. The goat, I'm not going to let the goat in the building. You're welcome to bring your dog here. I'm not going to complain, but no goats in the building. But be praying for the Christmas festival as things are quickly changing right now. Anybody else? Yes? No? Unspoken. There we go. You have a praise. Yeah, we are praising, the men are praising Christy for tamales. Good. There's that. Excellent. We're not done. We're not done. I know the 5 dozen tamales disappeared like they were gone. All right, well then let's pray and we'll turn to our study. Father, we thank you that you provide for us in so many ways that we don't expect. Forgive us when we try to do everything under our own power and instead of trusting you. Father, we do lift up the Christmas festival to you. It's your festival, and we're ready to do whatever you'll have us do, Father, and inside or outside whatever it takes. But we're going to spend this time in outreach to our community. Father, we do lift up those who are in need of healing. Particularly, we pray right now for Colleen Thomas. Father, we pray that you would calm her spirit. I can just imagine her in a hospital for multiple days as not being a very happy person. Father, I pray that you would just be with her and calm her spirit. I pray for the doctors you've appointed to her charge, that they would be divinely guided as they seek the answers that are needed to find out just what's gone on. We pray for those who are also in need of healing from various illnesses, including COVID. Well, I want to pray for Gary Isdry's son, who is in Arizona. His father found out that his son had COVID while I was with him on the phone today. We just pray for his healing as well. As we always pray, Lord, we do pray for revival in our nation. We are in great need of a spiritual change, changed hearts from coast to coast and border to border. Father, we'd ask now that you'd be with us as we spend more time in your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Yeah, another prayer request just to put on your back burner prayer. I had a conversation today with the director of Northwest Church Planning, Gary Isdry is his name. You've actually met one of the men that work for him, Tim Howe, Tim and Tom Howe. You might remember they're twin brothers. Both had the same job, one in Texas and one in Washington. Again, talking about where we might fit in some kind of mission work, church plant somewhere in the Northwest. Darrington didn't work out. Anchorage is not where we're supposed to be going steadily. So still looking. And while I was having this Zoom conversation with him today, his son texted him and said that he had COVID. So that's why I brought that up. But I don't know. Somewhere in the Northwest, we're going to go make an impact in the name of Jesus. That's, they need it. They need it. All right, so 1 Corinthians 15. What I didn't do is bring my Bible, this, which is going to make it, I'm going to go back and forth electronically. This is one of those times where I'd like to have a paper Bible in my hand. So last week we went through just two verses, actually. We're doing this section 20 through 28, and we just looked at 20 through 22. And I'm going to read that and then go ahead and read all the way through verse 28 tonight, and then we'll start. So starting at verse 20 in the, wrong version of the Bible here. I'm using the ESV Bible, the English Standard. Read full chapter. Okay. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also all in Christ, also in Christ shall all be made alive. But each in his own order. This is what we'll be starting tonight. Christ the first fruits, then at his coming those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end, when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father after destroying every rule and every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death, for God has put all things in subjection under his feet. But when it says all things are put in subjection, it is plain that he accepted who put all things in subjection under him. When all things are subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to him who put all things in subjection under him, that God may be all in all. All right. So if Christ is indeed the first fruits of God's resurrection harvest, then the another question should pop to, into your mind is, well, why hasn't he harvested the rest? Right? I mean, what's the deal? So what is taking so long in bringing the rest of the harvest, as Christ is the first fruits, what is taking so long to bring the rest of those who have believed in Christ from the dead? So if this was a question that was going on during Paul's day, then this question is all the more pressing nearly 2,000 years later as we continue to await the resurrection of the dead. So he was asking or dealing with, well, why haven't the rest been resurrected? And that was just like, you know, not too long after the Lord's death. So here we are 2,000 years later asking the same question. So in verses 23 through 28, he explains that this delay in time comes not from any slowness on God's part, but because God is completing the fullness of his plan. And this plan is nothing less than a full-scale military assault against all of God's enemies, including, we just heard it in the scripture, death itself. A military assault on death led by King Jesus on behalf of his people, this great cosmic war. In the intervening time between Christ's resurrection and our resurrection, Paul here teaches that Christ is right now completing his military mission, his royal rescue mission. Caution as I go through, I'm not doing an eschatological teaching tonight. We are going to deal with some timeline issues just the way Paul does, but and now you'll see the detail as we get to it. But it, don't expect this to be a end times sequencing teaching. That's not what Paul's doing here, and that's not what I'm going to do here. We'll have that time. You'll notice that it was, as I read through it, if you were keeping track of things, the millennial reign was kind of missing in Paul's vocabulary here. And if he's not teaching about it right now, nor am I. So I'm not going to try to turn one text into another text to tickle our ears. Amen? All right, so let's talk about our coming King Christ. Verse 23, if we could put 23 up. Of course, I don't have, there, thank you. But each in his own order, Christ the first fruits, then at his coming, those who belong to Christ. So he answers the part that this harvest, it's got to come in its own order, okay? Christ first, he's risen from the dead already. That's why we have Easter, right? Everybody with me on that? Okay, so we know that's happened. And while those who belong to Christ, using the vocabulary from 23, won't rise until Christ's coming. So in this verse, Paul carries forward, by the way, what do they call that time when Christ comes and the dead in Christ shall rise? And Paul carries forward his this agricultural metaphor of Christ as the first fruits. And he's also shifting and using military language in here as well to explain God's purpose and plans in this kind of two-stage resurrection. First fruits, everybody else. That's the two stages. So the word order, but each in his own order. In verse 23, it's actually a military term, and it doesn't necessarily mean sequence as much as it means rank or brand. Like the order of the knights or whatever. It's not so much sequence, but rank or brand of soldiers. And it shows the entirety of those raised from the dead as one army who are divided into different companies and battalions. First Christ, then everybody else, then his people. So it's not like we're going to go all be resurrected one after the other, right? And that's kind of what the impression is when you hear, you know, in order. This military order of everyone else is all going to be resurrected at the same time. Can you imagine that? Just, wow. So Christ, the captain of the Lord's army, I don't just use that term because I like military stuff. If we were to go to John 5:14 or Hebrews 2:10, we'd see that this captain of the Lord's army, or we could go back to Joshua and find the commanders of the Lord's army. These aren't just, you know, terms I'm using because I was a Marine. This is actually from the Greek. So this captain of the Lord's army arises first in this assault against, he told us who the enemy was, this assault against death, with the next rank or order of Christ's people arising on the last day as the final invasion against death's power. So this great military operation will take place, he tells us when, at Christ's coming. But each in his own order, Christ the first fruits, then at his coming, those who are in Christ. So we do have a very precise timing. Now, that term, at his coming, this is not the first time we see this in the New Testament talking about Christ's return. I'm just going to read a list of scriptures. It's a little lengthy, and if you want to write them down as I go through, you can look at them. All it will show you is how the word at his coming is used to describe his second coming. It's Matthew 24, verses 3, 27, 37, Matthew 39, 39, 1 Thessalonians 2:19, 3:13, 4:15, 5:23. So it goes on and on and on. It's used over and over again, coming. So the military metaphor of a two-stage assault clearly parallels the metaphor of a two-stage harvest. So two-stage assault, two-stage harvest. First fruits, everybody else. So they're running in parallel to each other. Christ first and the rest of his people with them. So going to 24 through 26 now, we'll talk about the coming, and now let's talk about the conquering. Then, Paul explains, comes the end. But each in his own order, Christ the first fruits, then at his coming, those who belong to Christ, then comes the end. So this, if you look at the fast pace of the writing in this chapter, commentators have differed wildly on the explanation of then is, and what end is. Sounds like Clinton, doesn't it? So we're kind of, it's important that we understand what or when then is and what the end is, because your view of then and the end greatly affects this chapter. So will then come immediately at Christ's coming, verse 23, or after some kind of millennial reign on earth? This is where I'm not going to spend a lot of time, because you could fit 1,000 years between these two words. And many commentators do, and I'm one of them, actually. And you would see that if you want a reference, you go to Revelation chapter 20, verse 3. So does this describe the end of the resurrection, or the end of Christ's redemptive work, or the end of time itself? What exactly ends? Good question. In context, then seems most likely to refer to Christ's coming, second coming. We're going to celebrate the first coming here in a couple weeks, so second coming. If Paul intended to teach that Christ would reign another 1,000 years at this point, before delivering his kingdom to the Father, it would be weird if he left that out right here. So that's not what he's trying to teach here. And then for the end, Paul seems to clarify exactly what he means. Here's what he said. The end is the time when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father after destroying every rule and every authority and power. Okay, putting that together, Paul's laying out a sequence. This is what Paul's teaching here. Christ was raised as the first fruits, the first order, the first rank. Then Christ is now destroying every rule, every authority, every power. When you hear those terms, rule, authority, principality, power, what are we talking about? Not just spiritual forces, but demonic spiritual forces or satanic spiritual forces. We're talking about those battalions of the enemy. Oh, funny how that works, huh? So he's destroying all the spiritual authority, principalities, powers, and then that's the second in the sequence. And the third, Christ's coming will take place after he completes that work. For he must, go back up to 23. Each his own order, Christ the first fruits, then at his coming, those who belong, then comes the end. So at Christ's coming, those who belong to Christ will ride as the remainder of the harvest, or rise as the remainder of the harvest, or the second order, or the second rank, or the second group. And then the fifth thing in his sequence here is the rest are raised from the dead. Christ will deliver the kingdom to God the Father. So the coming of Christ, everybody with me? Okay, so the coming of Christ represents the end of Christ's redemptive mission. The coming of Christ, when Christ comes, his redemption mission is over. All those principalities, authorities, all that have now been defeated, and there's nothing left for Christ to do but to raise his people from the dead and deliver the kingdom to God. Okay? So that's what we're talking about. Deliver the kingdom to God the Father. Important here, use your Trinity ears as we get towards the end, because there's some very important subtleties of doctrine. That part of the scripture I read that sounded so confusing to you about he puts in subjection that was under subjection so that he was subjected, all that part, it's very important doctrine. So use your Trinity ears here as we start going through here. So the Son is going to deliver the kingdom to God the Father. Got it? That's where we are so far. Now the word translated destroy in verses 24 and 26 in the ESV doesn't refer to the annihilation of those powers, but simply to destroy them by abolishing or rendering them null and void, or making them inoperable or inoperative. Paul means to teach that Christ will abolish every rule, every authority, and power set up in opposition to his reign, to his kingdom. Paul doesn't describe only hostile, rebellious sources of authority in this world. He says that Christ will abolish every rule and every authority and power. So the worldly powers and authorities can become rebellious against God, and we should remember that Paul teaches elsewhere that there is no authority, Romans 13:1, there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. So keep in mind that the authorities that are being destroyed are ones that he actually made. Okay, got that. With that in mind, Paul has a much broader vision for the abolition of those worldly powers and authority. Like the sun and moon will no longer be needed for light in the New Jerusalem, Revelation 21:23, because he is the light, right? Human institutions, governments, will no longer be needed to mediate God's authority temporally, so they're useless as well. And then Paul defines kingdom that Christ delivers to God the Father, verse 24, in the following verse, for he must reign until he has put all enemies under his feet. That's verse 25. One of my commentators, Lenski, writes this, quote, the kingdom denotes not the church or the persons of the saints, but the rule of Christ the King. His kingdom here on earth is found wherever he rules with his grace and his gifts. So the kingdom is the place where God's will is done on earth with the same readiness, the same joy as God's will is done in heaven. That sound familiar? On Yeah, right. So Christ has to reign then until he brings his conquering will to bear on all people, both his people who love him and his enemies who hate him alike. And then actually Paul starts quoting Psalm 110. He does that a lot. He quotes the Old Testament. 110 verse 1, in verse 25 he says, the Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. In Psalm 110, Yahweh, the Lord, says that he will put the Messiah's enemies under his feet. So Paul is applying the prophecy of Psalm 110 to Christ's reign at the right hand of the Father, which is the obvious upfront plain reading of verse 25, is that Christ who's putting the enemy, that is Christ who's putting the enemies under his own feet. Okay? Christ is putting the enemies under his own feet himself. No contradiction, no conflict in the two statements. Because the scripture, remember I said, put on your Trinity ears? So Psalm 110 is telling us that God the Father is putting this under the Son's feet. And here we have Paul telling us that he's basically doing it himself, not a problem. Just as the Father created through the Son and by the Holy Spirit, the Father is putting Christ's enemies under his feet through Christ's kingly reign and by the power of the Holy Spirit in the world. So the three are always indivisible, separate, yet indivisible. How's that for an oxymoron? Okay. Now, the last enemy that Christ will abolish is death itself. Verse 26, please. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. You could preach on that for a while. So what Paul does here first, and I've talked about this before, is he personifies death. He does by adding an article portraying death as the long-standing arch nemesis of God. It's death against God. So you can see how he's kind of personified death. So the long-standing arch nemesis of God in the world and the means of abolishing or rendering null and void, destroy. Remember I told you that's how it's translated. Death's power in this world is the resurrection, the way to destroy and make void death's power in the world is the resurrection. That completely undoes death, right? Death then absolutely loses its hold on Christ's people forever, never to trouble us again. Once that resurrection happens, death lost its grip. It has been rendered, now you see the difference between destroyed and null and void or inoperable. Death has been rendered inoperable, null and void. Right now, believers that have already experienced death in part, but it's not into eternity. Those who are dead now, that were dead in Christ, they won't be dead forever. They are going to be completely resurrected. So while our bodies continue to waste away, the resurrection life of Christ is being renewed every day, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16. And just like with our relationship to sin, death remains in us, a lingering issue, even when you're saved, but it no longer reigns over us because it's going to be destroyed. Christ's reign breaks into the lives of believers now, promising that he will bring us the fullness of his resurrection when he comes again. Then when he returns, Christ will bring this great rescue mission to its completion by raising the people from the dead, abolishing death's power forever. Game over. And now he's got to reign. So verse 27, go ahead and put 27 and 28 up. For God has put all things, I'm going to read it very slowly. God has put all things in subjection under his feet. So who did the putting here? God. But when he says all things are put in subjection, it's plain that he is accepted or set aside, not included is a better way of looking at that. Him or who put all things in subjection under him. Okay? And go ahead to verse 28, please. When all things are subjected to him, that's why this is titled tonight, All in All. When all things are subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to him who put all things in subjection under him, that God may be all in all. Paul quotes Psalm 8, verse 6 here. When he says he's put all things in subjection under his feet, that's coming from Psalm 8. And in Psalm 8, David is marveling at God's grace to give human beings dominion over the earth at the beginning of creation. Genesis chapter 1, verses 28, 29. And Paul just reminded us, however, that Adam forfeited this dominion by his sin so that he and all his descendants received death as a punishment for sin. That was what we talked about in verse 22 last week. A parallel passage is in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 5 through 8. And Paul here explains the dominion of humankind over creation described in Psalm 8 as being fulfilled in Christ, the last Adam. In fact, I want you to hear that. Can you put up Hebrews chapter 2, verses 5 through 8? I mean, we've got time, right? Let's not leave anything undone. I want you to see how these two run parallel to each other. Now it was not to angels, do you see the words already coming up in the parallel? It was not to angels that God subjected the world to come, of which we are speaking. It has been testified somewhere, what is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you care for him? You made him for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor, putting everything in subjection under his feet. So the same writer here, who we don't have a definitive answer and who wrote Hebrews, the same writer is also quoting verse 8 of, or Psalm chapter 8, putting everything in subjection under his feet. Now in putting everything in subjection to him, he left nothing outside his control. At present, we do not yet see everything in subjection to him. So he explains that the dominion of humankind over creation described in Psalm 8 has been fulfilled in Christ, that last Adam. That was in verses 45 and 46, same chapter. So to this statement about the rule of a new man over creation, Paul gives us a qualifier here. He says, verse 27, it is plain that he is accepted who put all things in subjection under him. Now, when I read that, I said, what I told you is when you hear that accepted, I told you set aside or set apart or excluded. So here's what this means. God's administrators of God's reign over creation. God never intended for human beings to reign over him. Everybody got that? I'm going to do this sentence by sentence. This is going to come crystal clear to you here in just a second. And you are going to go, oh, I never got that before. So get ready for one of those moments here. So God never intended for human beings to reign over him, correct? Jesus is what? 100% and 100% man. Oh, hold on. Stay with me now. I just wanted to introduce that thought because we're going to get somewhere. So he never intended for humans to reign over him, but he intended to put all created things in subjection under the feet of human beings. We just read that in Hebrews. It wasn't to the angels, but to us, right? All things under the feet of human beings, and it would be impossible for the Creator to be ruled by his creatures. So Paul points out this subtle but little critical difference. The one that's accepted. Christ came to become the mediator, to reconcile God and human beings, to bring them together, not to separate God from human beings. God's reign as Jesus, God, man, mediator, that's a provisional reign. It's only for a time. He is only 100% human for this full redemptive, resurrected mission, rescue mission, and assault against the final enemy, death, until that's over. At that point, verse 28, when all things are subjected to him, including the final enemy, death, then Christ the mediator delivers the kingdom to God the Father, and his mission is complete. Paul speaks as of Christ as the Son in this verse, not to say that the Son is the Son as the Son will be subjected to the Father. That's not the case. The three persons in the Trinity are one God, the same in substance, equal in power and glory, Baptist faith and message. Okay, so Jesus is not being subjected to God the Father. Christ unites two whole natures of God and man into one person. That's what Christ did. That's what the incarnation is about. God with us, right? God became man. And the scriptures commonly attribute actions or experiences proper for one nature to the other nature. Paul stated that the rulers of this age, 1 Corinthians 2, verse 8, crucified the Lord of glory. So Paul says the Son must be subjected to God. In both cases, it's not that Christ can suffer. It's not that Christ can be made subject according to his godly nature. But it's the Son, the human nature, that suffers and is made subject according to his work as the God-man, the mediator between God and men. Paul's not saying that Christ shall cease to rule. Gabriel promised Mary, we talked about this last week in my Sunday message, of his kingdom there will be no end. That's what the angel told Mary, remember? What Paul tells us here is simply that the nature of Christ's rule now changes because it is over. It's the end. He has come and people have been resurrected. He will no longer reign as God-man, 100% God, 100% man. Everything necessary to rescue humanity from sin, from death, from the devil, it's all been done now. Death has been completely defeated. From that point on, once the restoration is total, Christ will reign as God, that God may be all in all. I seldom quote John Calvin, but I'm going to tonight because he has a good grip on this. Here's what he says. John Calvin, we acknowledge, it is true, God is the ruler, but it is in the face of the man Christ. But Christ will then restore the kingdom which he has received, that we may cleave wholly to God. Nor will he in this way resign the kingdom, but will transfer it in a manner from his humanity to his glorious divinity. Because a way of approach will then be opened up from which our infirmity now keeps us back. Thus then, Christ will be subjected to the Father, because the veil being then removed, we shall openly behold God reigning in his majesty. And Christ's humanity will then no longer be interposed, or part of Christ, to keep us back from a closer view of God. When this is complete, then we will... I wrote re-will twice. Enjoy, quote, the immediate vision and fruition of God the Father, of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit, all in one for all eternity. Of Christ's kingdom there will be no end. But he's not reigning as a man. That's been subjected. He will reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit as God. So we have everything all in. Does that now make a little more sense to you? Father, thank you for a chance to look at what sounds like very complicated scripture. Thank you that in Christ, 100% human, 100% God, the redemption of mankind was made possible and completed and will be completed at the resurrection of the dead. And then at that time, Father, he will present you the kingdom. And all things will be put under his feet, except Christ the King. Be with us as we return to our homes tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.